This is a special privilege to host Steve Radelet, both because he's been a remarkable player in the world of think tanks, the world of ideas, but also the world of policy. He served as the senior economist for USAID under Raj Shah when Raj was the administrator. He also served as a deputy assistant secretary of the Treasury in a very similar role. He is the author of a book that I think is really an important book entitled The Great Surge. And it talks about the sort of where we stand in the world of economic development and gives, I think, probably the most exhaustive account and the most thoughtful description. So I hope you'll all read it. You get a sneak preview through our conversation, but it's an exceptional book. And Steve is right now at Georgetown, spreading his wisdom. But we get to have a conversation with him tonight. So welcome, Steve.
Thank you. Thank you.
So, in essence, your book makes the case there's been great economic development success, that we've seen many lifted from poverty, many developing countries on a very positive trajectory. Give us a sense of the metrics you use. What is the measures of success you're seeing?
So, I look at lots of different measures of success, and what really struck me and one of the motivations for reading this is that at almost any measure of development over the last 25 years, there had been astonishing progress. So one is the number of people living in what the World Bank defines as extreme poverty. That is under $1.25 a day. They've just redefined it to be $1.90 a day with a shift in prices, but either way, it's about the same number. Throughout human history, the number of people living in extreme poverty, under $1 a day, under $1.25 a day, rose and rose and rose from the beginning of time as global population grew. 200 years ago, almost everybody was living in what we would now call extreme poverty. And it rose and rose until around 1990. And for the first time ever, it began to fall, and it fell like a rock. In 1993, there were 2 billion people in the world, if you can believe it, living under $1.25 a day. Right? $10 a day, you know, for a family for a small-sized family. It's nothing. That was 1993. Now, by 2012, that number was down to 1 billion. So after rising from the beginning of time, for 2 billion people in 1993, it dropped to 1 billion in 2012. And by best estimates, in 2015, we're down to about 700 million people. Now, that's still 700 million people. I don't want to declare victory, but that's an astonishing drop in two decades. That's poverty. We can think about health. Infant mortality rates have dropped by 75%. In 1980, 22% of children in developing countries died before their fifth birthday. 22% around the world. We would never accept that, obviously. It's a horrifying number. And that was in 1980. I mean, not that long ago. Today, that number is down to less than 5%. That die before their fifth birthday, which is still horrible and still unacceptable, but it dropped from 22% to 5% in three decades, which means that 17%, 17 out of 100 kids that would have died just three decades ago now live. And here's the astonishing thing about that statistic on child mortality. It has fallen since 1980 in every single country in the world, period. No exceptions. It's fallen in North Korea. It's fallen in the Central African Republic. It's fallen in Haiti. It's fallen in every single country in the world. And there's nothing like that I've ever seen in any other statistics. So that's on health. Maternal mortality is also down. Malaria deaths have been cut in half since 2000. HIV deaths are down by a third since 2005. Tuberculosis deaths are down by about a third. Life expectancy is up by about 6 years around the world. Turning to education. Women, 93% of women are now literate around the world. It was only 50% just a couple of decades ago. More and more girls are completing school. Only about half of girls completed primary school in the 1980s. Today it's 85%. Global hunger has been cut in half. The spread of more countries are democracies than ever before. In the 1980s, only a handful of developing countries were democracies. Today, more than half are democracies. Still, a lot of them are not, but more than half of countries in the world are democracies. And despite what you read in the headlines with the horrible tragedies in Syria and Afghanistan and the conflicts that are around the world, here's the one that nobody believes. There's less conflict in the world than ever before. We live at one of the most peaceful times in world histories, whether you count the number of wars or whether you count the number of people dying in wars. And I do not for a moment want to minimize the horrible tragedies that are unfolding. But we forget that 30 years ago, all of Central America was at war with each other, El Salvador, Honduras, Guatemala. We forget that all of Southern Africa was in flames at the end of apartheid and was at war with each other. We forget how horrible Southeast Asia was alongside the Middle East, and that was just three decades ago. So there's much less conflict. So almost any indicator that you care to look at, hundreds of millions of people around the world are better off today than they were just three decades ago.
Now, the period during which you've seen these extraordinary changes, where you go from 2 billion to 1 billion living in abject poverty, it's also a time in which there have been two other things have occurred. And one is extraordinary technology innovation. Yep. And the other is economic integration as a result of pretty purposeful policy. So to what degree are these benefits the result of aid? And to what degree are they the result of the opening and connecting of economies and of just economic growth in places like China and India?
Yeah, so it's a combination. Aid plays an important secondary role, but it's not the main driver. But the two forces that you mentioned are actually deeply integrated. Global technology cannot play the role that it has played without global integration, without globalization. When I hear sometimes from my brilliant students, including Jason, who's sitting in the first row over here, and it wasn't Jason, but I hear sometimes from my students, oh, I'm against globalization. And I love to throw back, so why are you against vaccines getting from Indiana to a village in northern Mozambique? Because that's globalization. Mm-hmm. Not to say that everything about global integration is a good thing. It's not. But getting vaccines to children around the world is the best of globalization. Pulling together private businesses and international organizations and local actors so that kids can live. Cell phones, obviously, the internet are ways that we integrate with each other. But it's through trade and openness that these technologies, these innovations of better medicines, of immunizations, of knowledge of what works and what doesn't work, of new seed varieties, of fertilizers, can move around the world. And that accelerated dramatically in the 1980s and 1990s. Things like shipping containers, it turns out, played an enormously positive role because all of a sudden shipping could happen faster with much less insurance, much less breakage, and things could move around the world. And so the most remote ports could be integrated with Los Angeles and San Francisco and New York. So global integration has played a really big role in terms of driving technology. But it has also opened up opportunities for trade and for jobs. China has been a big part of this story, obviously in and of itself, because there's so many people living in China, but also as a driver for their integration, the Chinese economy integration with the rest of the world. And that's a bit of a worrying sign at the moment. But China, we all talk about China as manufacturing everything and making everything that's being exported around the world. They import almost as much as they export, which means they are a market for developing countries around the world. So that integration through technology, through trade, through finance has brought a lot of challenges for sure, but overall it has created enormous opportunities for people living in the world's poorest countries to have higher income and to take better care of their families.
Mm-hmm. And I think we'll get to, I think probably in questions, the ways in which some of the trends that are enabling all this good news can also be unsettling for states. Yeah. and create a different set of pressures. Mm-hmm. You referred to a few public-private partnerships mm-hmm. when you were just talking then. And in the book, I think some of the most interesting examples of success stories ended up being when the three sectors got together. You
right.
cited, when it comes to food security, the Green Revolution, you cited GAIN. It's like Global Alliance for Improved Nutrition, I think is the right name for mm-hmm. GAIN. Mm-hmm. Talk about those two examples and what kinds of outcomes you saw as a result.
You know, I always get a little bit tired of people framing debates about is it the private sector or is it the government? And of course, it's both. It's trying to get the balance right, because you can't, in this country or any other country, we know that you can't have a vibrant private sector and entrepreneurship and investment without an effective state that creates the rules of the game, where there's the rule of law, where there's property rights, where there's public education systems, where there's infrastructure, and it's getting that balance right. And it drives me crazy when people try to think that it's one or the other, when the real question is, how do we integrate both the private business, government actors, public actors, and also philanthropists and foundations. And where that works well, that's where big gains have been made. And we saw that 50 years ago with the Green Revolution, where it took support from the Ford Foundation and the Rockefeller Foundation, working with USAID and then later the World Bank, working with some of the leading scientists in the world, working with local research institutions in the Philippines and in South Asia to develop these new seed varieties that would work in the context primarily of South and Southeast Asia, that could work on small plots of land where there was lots of rainfall and a lot of labor, that all of a sudden we could shorten the growing time for seed, for rice and wheat, so that they could grow three or four crops a year instead of two, where each crop would have more seed on it. And all of a sudden, we went from thinking that Asia was going to be a population disaster, where we wouldn't be able to feed the millions of people that were being born into Asia in the 60s and 70s, into an economic powerhouse. And for all of the Asian miracle, it started with the Green Revolution, and it went from what people thought was going to be a hunger disaster, you know, into this great powerhouse. So that's one. And then on GAIN, the Global Alliance on Nutrition, is a similar story, taking those ideas on agriculture, but recognizing that just growing more food doesn't get you far enough in terms of nutrition, that it's got to have the right nutrients, it's got to have the right vitamins, and getting the right kinds of nutrition to children. And that, again, took an alliance of business working with foundations and investors and governments to make these work. And any one of those actors alone couldn't have achieved those. And I'm back on vaccines as another example, and I mentioned it briefly, but you need the private sector, the businesses that with the smart scientists that invent the vaccine, working with the U.S. government, USAID, and others that fund those vaccines and make them affordable to the world's poor, working with the UN agencies that are around the world, working with local actors and local foundations in order to get those vaccines to kids that need. And that's what got Bill and Melinda Gates involved, as you know, is they read the World Bank's annual report, the World Development Report on health. And Bill Gates is a technology guy, and he had worked on a business model that you create the new technology, and then the market will take care of it. You have to have a marketing wing, but getting it out there is not the challenge. Building the great technology is the challenge. And he reads about immunizations, and he can't believe that hundreds of millions of kids are not getting vaccinated. He said, wait a minute, we have this technology. It's saving millions of lives. It costs 5 cents. And he couldn't understand why it wasn't getting to people. So it was exactly this issue of getting that technology to the poorest people in the world that got him motivated, where he's done so much good.
And I think you're referring to Gavi, going into this, coming up with acronyms, but the Global Alliance
for Vaccines and Immunizations.
Gavi, which is a really quite remarkable organization, what it's done. I mean, in fact, immunizations are now, I forgot what the numbers are, but it is extraordinary coverage now compared to what it was.
We're up about in the high 80s percentile, so there's still actually more to go. But 3 decades ago, it was below 50% of kids in developing countries that were getting the basic vaccines.
So you referred to some technology innovations, and we can go back to that as well. But I want to think a little bit about social innovations, because that, in fact, these partnerships fall in that category squarely. I think when Bill Gates looked at this problem as a general matter, he saw a market failure. He saw that there were no market incentives for developing vaccines and cures for the diseases of the poor, because the poor couldn't afford the product that resulted. What were some of the things that they did, along with Rockefeller Foundation and others, to create a different incentive systems so for pharmaceuticals.
So here's the problem. A pharmaceutical company faces really high costs to develop a new vaccine or, say, against malaria, a malaria vaccine. And the scientists that I know say, look, this is possible. It's going to take years of research, but we can develop a vaccine for malaria, but it's going to cost billions of dollars. And who's the market? The poorest people in the world who are living on a dollar a day, $2 a day.
In poor countries.
How do you get it there, and who's going to actually pay for it? And when you add up the number of vaccines times the price that they can pay, it's not enough of a market. That's one problem. And the other problem that they often voiced is, we make a vaccine for malaria, we will immediately be put on the spot to give it away free. And if we successfully invent the vaccine, if we do not give it away for free, we are cast as horrible people. That's our reward for developing a vaccine with the potential to save millions of lives. So the risk is that they'd spend all this money and they'd get pasted for being evil for not giving it away. So the incentives are not good. Much better to take care of hair loss, which is not my problem. But people will pay a lot of money for that, and it's a lot safer. So the incentives are all wrong. So they did a couple things. One was just basic fund the research directly, so that it would reduce the cost of scientists and the upfront cost. But that's only a partial solution. Second, what they started to do was to create the incentives to developing countries that they would give them the money to buy the vaccines in a fairly simple way, that instead of actually paying for the vaccines and having them delivered, they would ask countries to go forward and begin to vaccinate kids, and then they would pay them after the fact $15 per vaccinated kid. No questions asked. You don't have to trace the money. You don't have to do all the paperwork of routing it. All you have to do is prove that we vaccinated 100,000 kids, and then they'll pay you after the fact $15, because that's basically the cost of what it would be. And it just made the bureaucracy a lot simpler and created the right incentives for countries to recognize that they would get reimbursed by Gavi to do that. So that was the second thing they did. The third thing they're working on is actually to work on what's called an advanced market commitment, where you actually set aside in advance several billion dollars that is meant to mimic a final market to sell several hundred malaria vaccines at $15 a pop or whatever it would be. And up front, you put together $3 billion or whatever it is to say that the money is there. It is committed. There it is. It's in the bank. And that money will go to the first FDA-approved malaria vaccine that, when you can sell it, you don't have to worry about the fact that these are the poorest people in the world. That's the pot of money that will pay for it and will make up your cost with enough profit, enough rate of return, that it's worthwhile doing that. And they've done that for a couple of vaccines with smaller markets, and they're working on one with malaria. So they're doing a couple of really interesting things, recognizing that private sector incentives are not the enemy. It's a fabulous force that we need to harness to solve some of the world's biggest problems.
Often you hear people refer to philanthropy's role as a catalytic one, and that's a great example of precisely that. Mm-hmm. One of the things, I don't want to stay with the Gates Foundation all that long, but one of the things that foundation is focused on is the eradication of specific diseases.
Right.
So, for example, the eradication of polio has been a very important mission for them. But even when you look at these disease-specific approaches, there is a role for ensuring that you've strengthened health systems in the process,
yeah.
Right? And so that when you leave, that country has got the capability to deal with the next disease.
Yep.
And so talk about that.
Well, and this is going to bring us right into Ebola. As what happens when we don't strengthen the system.
I need to say that Steve Radelet, also I should have mentioned this, is an advisor to President Sirleaf in Liberia, and so very knowledgeable about these issues.
So part of the incentives, unfortunately, within aid agencies these days, we're so focused on results. We're going to do results. And one of the most successful programs that we've had in the United States in the last 15 years is the President's Emergency Program for AIDS Relief, PEPFAR, that President Bush announced in the 2003 State of the Union address with the target initially of getting 3 million people on antiretrovirals. We're now up to about 9 million people on antiretrovirals, where U.S. tax dollars are unequivocally saving millions of lives. There's no question about it, actually, none, because the money is going to buy antiretrovirals, and people are using them, and people live when they have antiretrovirals. And it's been a great success. And actually, watching the State of the Union the other day, thinking that there could be a foreign aid program for billions of dollars, the original cost was $5 billion, that would get $15 billion over $15 billion over 5 years, that could get both sides of the aisle jumping up and applauding. I thought, we've moved from that world. Anyway, the downside of that is that it's all about getting results on HIV/AIDS, all about getting antiretrovirals out, and not about training the doctors, training the nurses, building the clinics, getting the clinics out to the most remote areas, doing the unsexy things of logistics, of supply chain management, of how do we get the drugs off the boat into a cold storage place where they'll stay good, and how do we get them trucked out. All of that stuff that needs to work for an entire health system to work, the incentives for USAID and others are not to cover that stuff, because everything Congress wants to know is how many people are on antiretrovirals, period. And so you have a very narrow focus, where sometimes our drive for results pushes us to do only the things that we can measure well, and we don't build the systems. And one of the risks for that, of course, is that when some unknown disease comes along, like Ebola, you don't have the systems in place to deal with it, because everything is geared for another system. And this has been one of our weaknesses. Health systems are much better than they once were, but they're still far too weak. And so a country like Liberia, that was so desperately poor and so ravaged by war, that had made actually a lot of progress in the previous 8 years or so, still had not made that much progress with where they had the defenses up against one of the world's biggest killers that came out of nowhere, and that no one, not a single person in the country, had any experience even recognizing what this disease was, and got no help, unfortunately, from the international community until they were 2 or 3 months into the crisis, and it was way over the top. But it is a good example of how an approach that focuses on building public systems is going to get you longer-term benefits than just focusing on the specifics.
And when you look at it, the three countries most affected, Guinea, Sierra Leone, and Liberia, all had just recently come out of civil war.
Yeah.
They were all on a good, very good trajectory, and this was a huge setback. So help us understand. You're right next door, right nearby, Nigeria, and there was a case in Nigeria. Nigeria was able to contain.
Right.
What were the differences, the central differences? What should we draw from those two experiences?
So I think there are two. One is that Nigeria did have stronger systems. They got more doctors and better trained doctors. They had not gone through such a devastating civil war, so their system, their health system was a little bit better than those countries. That was one. But the other and more important factor was that they had warning, because where Liberia and Guinea and Sierra Leone had no warning at all. This thing came out of nowhere and was not recognized. And by the time people did recognize it, hundreds and hundreds, probably more than 1,000 people had died. Overall, 10,000 finally died. But by the time people recognized what it was already all over the place. And they lost about a third of their doctors and healthcare workers in Liberia and Sierra Leone because people came into the clinic. They were sick. It looked like they had malaria, big fever, and other kinds of things. And all of a sudden, everybody in the hospital is infected. Nigeria, it was exploding in the other three countries. Nigeria could hear about it, knew that it was in the area, and could begin to build up very quickly the defenses at the border, at the airport, and other places so that they could detect it and could begin to say, if you've got a fever, we think that might be Ebola, which was not the case in the other three countries. So they were able to put those systems in place, and when that first case came in, they were able to get it right away and stop it from spreading further.
Another interesting aspect of this is that, of course, the polio eradication effort was underway in Nigeria. Clinics had been built. You had a partnership in place with the health ministry, with WHO, with UNICEF, with the Rotarians, with Gates and others. They could simply, and in fact, an indigenous philanthropist, Aliko Dangote, had also helped finance, and they could repurpose that very infrastructure. It is to me a fascinating lesson on how you can how things can work. We've talked a little bit about the role for technology, obviously in nutrition and in health. What about financial services? What about in commerce? What about the opportunity for the poor to start small businesses, to connect their products to markets, et cetera? How have we used technology to provide the sort of core financial services that people need to have to protect their herd or to have a savings account, et cetera?
So to answer that, let me actually step back a little bit and end up there. Because I think you have to put that, the financial services, and especially the international financial services, in the context of the global trade that we talked about, but in a broader context of what happened and why so many countries began to change. So the defining changes came in the 1980s and 1990s. First of all, when China opens up, when Mao Zedong does the world a favor and keels over in 1976, and the most impoverished country in the world, which was what China was at the time, fundamentally changes direction beginning in 1980 under Deng Xiaoping, which opens up the door for, frankly, the end of communism. It's the beginning of the end of communism and the opening of more market-oriented economic systems, which gets us to that eventually. That, of course, is coupled with the huge change in November of 1989 when the Berlin Wall falls and we have the demise of the Soviet Union. And with that becomes a fundamental shift in ideas around most of the world towards more market-oriented economic systems and towards more open and democratic political systems. Not everywhere, but a huge shift. And those global changes echoed around the world, that we now have not just China going forward, even though it's slowing down, not just India, but literally dozens and dozens of countries around the world. The majority of developing countries, about 70 around the world, have fundamentally changed their economic and political trajectory since the early 1990s. And there are many pieces to that, but one of those is local actors in the business community. And with this change in ideology around both political openness but economic openness comes more of a reliance on markets. Not, you know, free markets and completely, Adam Smithian neoclassical economics, but moving towards more sensible economic systems where people have the opportunity to open their own business and to get financing and to find their own markets. And so it unleashes, that broader change creates the seeds for small and medium enterprises and larger enterprises to begin to flourish. And part of that comes through international financing, but more and more of it comes through local financing and local trade efforts as well. And what those forces did was just create opportunities for people. I always think of development as opening opportunities for people, creating opportunities. And people are smart enough that when you open up new opportunities, they'll take them. And a lot of the history of development over hundreds and hundreds of years had been opportunities closed off because of colonialism, frankly, hundreds and hundreds of years of colonialism. Because after the end of colonialism, their own new generation of leaders were mostly pretty nasty dictators who continued to close off opportunities. And only in the 80s and 90s, opportunities began to open up. And part of that, now back to your question, was about local leaders in the business community taking advantage of that and creating new businesses, both large and small, being able to tap into local financial networks and sometimes regional or global financial networks, where regional banks began to lend more often. And people could do things as simple as using a local microfinance institution to buy more sewing machines, to begin to open up a local business to do that, to a medium-sized enterprise that might be making clothes at a larger level to larger industries that are making jeans or shoes or soccer balls that are being exported to the global market. And not that all of those stories are great. Both economic reform and political change are inherently disruptive forces, and there are people who lose out from that, both politically and economically, from those disruptive forces. But the larger story is that those disruptive forces have opened opportunities for entrepreneurs and businesses, both large and small, that have created these opportunities for incomes to grow. And I'll just throw out one more statistic. The average income in developing countries, average income after inflation, for not including China, has doubled since 1995. It's doubled for several billion people. Their average income has doubled in real terms over the last 20 years, excluding China.
So you touched on two topics I don't want to lose.
Not just
and,
I,
and
I think
one,
I touched on more
there,
than
yeah,
two.
There are 18. I'm only picking up two. So you know, in your sweep of history, you went pretty quickly over the Cold War, and I want to ask you about that because in your book, what you say is that, you know, the things that enabled this good news were technology, it was economic globalization, but it was also the end of the Cold War. To what extent did the Cold War distort our policies, our foreign policy more broadly, but our economic development policy in particular?
Yep. A lot is the short answer. And again, I'm going to go back even further to colonialism, where European countries, the United States and others, took over territories primarily for the purpose of extracting natural resources for our own gain and to drive parts of the Industrial Revolution. And that, in terms of development, it really, again, closed off the opportunities for development. Local folks did not get to go to school. They did not have access to basic health care and the advances in immunizations and other advances in health care that were being developed in Western Europe were not spreading to the rest of the world, and that was that pattern. You know, obviously, I can't completely characterize 400 years of colonial history. It differed by country, but it lasted for hundreds of years, and that began to change. Obviously, after the end of World War II, and then especially in the 1960s, where finally developing countries were given their independence, but that coincided with the Cold War, in which the incentives for our own and for the Soviet Union's geopolitical means was to help install new leaders in those countries that followed many of the same traits of the colonial masters before. That was about resource extraction for a few people, the leaders and their family and their friends, not for the general good. To not allow resources as far as they should for education and health. And we supported that, and the Soviets supported that through the power game of the Cold War, and it went back before the end of World War II. Franklin Roosevelt talked about Anastasio Somoza in Nicaragua, and said famously about him, "He may be a son of a bitch, but he's our son of a bitch." And I think that kind of summarizes the attitude. So we supported the Duvaliers in Haiti. We supported Mobutu in Zaire, and the Soviets supported the Derg in Ethiopia. And we coddled and supported some of the world's nastiest dictators for our own ends. And with that, there was a lot of violence. The wars in the Korean Peninsula, the wars in Southeast Asia, the Vietnam War, the wars around the end of apartheid. Apartheid was totally embedded in the Cold War, because we were supporting the apartheid white government because they feared the communists of the ANC. And the ANC was supported, and their supporters were supported by the Soviet Union. And one of the craziest incidents of this, it's in a country now called Namibia, which was Southwest Africa, was a UN protectorate that South South Africa basically took over and tried to invade. And the opposition from that came from Angola in the north in an organization called the Southwest African People's Organization, SWAPO, where in the 1980s we had Cuban troops fighting with SWAPO, attacking from the north from Angola, financed by the Soviet Union, fighting in this little desert against South African troops financed by us, of course, fighting for this, going to a nasty war that went on for decades. It's happening in Mozambique. Of course, everything in Central America was a puppet war about the Cold War. So with the end of the Cold War, that leads to a massive reduction in violence around the world, and this not a complete ending, but much less occasion where we support open-ended some of the world's nastiest dictators. Sometimes that still happens, but not to the extent that it once did. And again, what that led to was both political and economic openness in countries as far-flung as Mongolia, to Mozambique, next door to South Africa, to all of Latin America. Think back Latin America 30 years ago. They were all run by generals. Every single country in Latin America was a non-democracy with some kind of military leadership. Pinochet in Chile and the generals in Argentina that invaded the Falklands, they're all gone. Latin America is now, for the most part, with the exception of Venezuela and a couple of other places, thriving democracies, struggling in many ways, but the generals and the wars that went with it are gone. So the end of the Cold War ended that that system in which we and the Soviets were propping up the wrong folks and began to open up these political opportunities. So it's really only in the last couple of decades that the majority of people in developing countries have even had the chance, politically and economically, to begin to move forward.
In your book, you're very clear in saying that the fourth important driver was, in fact, the emergence of some terrific local leaders,
yep.
And that was essential.
Yep, yeah. So, the end of the Cold War and all of what I just described was a global phenomenon. The rise of China was important, obviously, in China and its trading partners, pretty much a global phenomenon. The spread of technology, none of that really answers a big puzzle. So, all right, two-thirds of developing countries have really moved forward, but there's another third that haven't. Haiti is still stuck. Somalia does not have an effective government. About half of sub-Saharan Africa is moving forward, but the other half is not. The Central African Republic is a bit of a mess and gone back to war. Myanmar, we're all hopeful that it's finally beginning to emerge, but it hadn't. Most of Central Asia is not. And what's the difference? Why did some emerge and some didn't? And I think the answer really just lies in local leadership and the particular people who emerged at that moment in history that were committed to moving their countries forward in a positive way. And that to some people that sounds like, well, it can't just rely on just the movement of a few, the decisions of a few key individual people. But in fact, there are many turning points in world history that's exactly the difference that it makes. When there's a vacuum, there's a moment for change, and if the wrong person is in charge, it can move a country in the very wrong direction. With the right person in charge, you can move forward. And the best example, and I use this in the book that I know of to show of that difference, is the difference between Robert Mugabe in Zimbabwe and President Mandela in South Africa. Both inherited similar situations. Actually, in many ways, Zimbabwe's was better. It had not quite been racked quite as badly by war. But Mandela pushed right from the beginning for an inclusive government, for the rainbow coalition of bringing together whites and blacks and coloreds and creating opportunities and resisting calls from his own party for vengeance. There were a lot of calls, and he had lots of justification where he could have gone after a lot of the perpetrators and thrown them in jail, where he could have taken white lands and when justified to do that. But his view was that was just going to perpetuate violence and ill will. And so he also resisted all of the calls for him to run for a second term and to be president for life. One term, and he voluntarily stood down, which was one of the most courageous decisions any political leader has made. But he knew that it wasn't about him, that it was about creating the system for open choice where people could choose their leaders. By contrast, Mugabe, it became all about him and his family and his friends, and it was all about using that opportunity to close off opportunities for most people and enrich himself. If Mugabe would have made different choices, Zimbabwe would be in a very different space today. So I think a lot of what distinguishes the countries that have succeeded from those that haven't are the choices of national political leaders, business leaders, community leaders, church leaders. It's leadership at different levels, but it is the people like Ellen Johnson Sirleaf, of Mandela, of Oscar Arias in Costa Rica, of those key, Lech Walesa in Poland, those key leaders that stood up, Cory Aquino in the Philippines, that stood up at those moments and led their countries in the right direction rather than taking that opportunity and trying to consolidate a dictatorship underneath themselves, which others made that choice.
So we're seeing there's a, we're very moved by the genocide in Rwanda and the job that Paul Kagame has done as a leader there in the wake of that. But he too has sought constitutional amendments so that he can run for a third term.
Yep.
What is your reaction to that?
So I think it's dangerous. I give Kagame a lot of credit. I'm a big fan of democracy. I actually think that it is as fundamental an aspect of development as infant mortality and poverty is, that you have to have a governance structure that over time may not look exactly like Western democracy, but is a system built on rights, on openness, on accountability, and giving people the right to choose their leader and hold them accountable. Having said that, I think following the genocide in Rwanda, it would have been anyone that would have argued for a multi-party election in the year following the genocide would have been nuts. It would have been complete failure, and they would have gone to war. A classic multi-party election right after that would not have worked. So I'm not so over the moon on democracy that it has to happen right away everywhere. But it's been 20 years. There's been enormous progress, more progress than anyone could have imagined after that genocide. So give Kagame his due. But it is dangerous for leadership to become so personalized in one actor that they keep perpetuating the rule and creating this belief that only that person has the adequacy to lead, because at some point it has to change. And the longer that person stays in power, the higher the likelihood that when the change comes, it will be violent and disruptive. Because anybody else who wants that position knows they're going to get one chance in life, and they'll do anything to take over power. And if Kagame violates the Constitution, why can't I? This will sound maybe a little homespun with the United States, but you know, one of the great mysteries and one of the greatest things that happened in the United States was George Washington somehow deciding that after two terms that was enough and he would voluntarily step down. And that was unheard of. That had never happened for any political leader ever in the world, any time. Rulers led for life. And for reasons that I certainly don't understand, he made that choice. And he handed off, I don't want to denigrate John Adams, but most historians think not quite the quality of leader of George Washington. Fine man, and it didn't hurt us in the long run. It was a great thing for us in the long run. It wasn't about the person of George Washington or the person of John Adams. It was about the institution that we were going to have political change, and power was not going to be centralized in one person. And I worry that Kagame, for all the good that he did, that it's becoming too personalized and not institutionalized as a system. And now is the opportunity for him to step back and hand over. A country that did do that, as you know, is Ghana, where Jerry Rawlings led from 1983, the third coup. he had one unsuccessful coup and two successful ones. Anyway, from 1983 until 2000, and he had the wisdom to step back and put his vice president up for election, and his vice president lost to an opposition candidate, John Kufuor. And Rawlings could have sent the army in 2000 in Ghana to say, the election was rigged, I'm taking it back. But he didn't. He let it stand. And that institutionalized democracy in Ghana. Kufuor ruled for two terms, and then he stepped down. And Rawlings, vice president candidate from 8 years before, was then elected.
This is President Mills?
This was Mills? John Otto Mills.
Yep.
He then died in office, which was a tragedy. But the institutions were in place that the army did not step in. His vice president took over. The Constitution ruled. And Ghana has had several elections since then with different parties winning, and it is seen as a legitimate process. And that's what you need to sustain the social and economic process over time is a legitimate political and governance system. And Kagame, for all of the benefits and all the gains that have been there, is risking all of that by staying on for a third term and not building that process for legitimate and stable political change.
Now, earlier we talked about the ways in which economic globalization has lifted many from poverty, but also left many behind. Mm-hmm. And we've got three different questions here, and I'm sure there were many more on the issue of inequality. This card says, yep. Who are the losers in this good news about economic development, and how can we help them? Mm-hmm. Second is, there's much higher inequality in most developed nations. Well, that's interesting, because that's also true, yep. than there was in 1990. What is your sense of the future on this? And then finally, Oxfam recently released a report about wealth distribution. Yeah. How does that report fit into the picture?
So, really good questions. So inequality is a really difficult concept to work with, because it can mean so many different things. It's different from poverty. The way we think about poverty, which is a little bit too simplistic, but the way we think about it is, here's an income level. $1.25 a day, $1.90 a day. In the United States, it's about $16 a day. We have our own poverty line. But we think of a poverty line, and you have an income, and you're either below it or above it. It's a little too simplistic, but we can get that, and we can count people. Inequality is really different, because inequality is comparing the income of an individual or a group to some other group. Well, who are the groups? Is it the richest countries of the world to the poorest countries? Is it the richest people to the poorest people? If it's the richest people, is it the richest 100 people, or is it the richest 1,000 people, or is it the richest 20% compared to the bottom 20%? Is it global, or is it within countries? And all of those are actually legitimate. None of those are right or wrong. They're all good, but they all tell you different things. And so when people say inequality is getting better or worse, you can, what kind of inequality are you talking about? Because the answer actually is a little bit different. But here are some of the big parameters. Globally, take away countries. Forget countries. We're all one country now. And just think of people, rich and poor people, and the distribution of income across rich and poor. There is no question that over the last 30 years, global income distribution has gotten much better after getting much worse for the previous 200 years. Previous 200 years, some people in the West, mostly us and our ancestors, got quite rich. Most of the rest of the world was left behind. With the opening of China, that began to reverse. And with China, basically with 2.5 billion people in China and India, most of them getting richer, while at a rate much faster than our incomes are growing, plus Indonesia, plus many other large countries, the global disparities of income have gotten actually much smaller. So globally, income distribution, if you put away countries, is getting better. Within countries, the story is much more mixed. We all know the story in the richest countries in the United States. Income distribution is getting worse, and has been since the 1980s. And in developing countries, it's a mixed story. Basically, a little bit depending on how you measure distribution within countries, about a third of developing countries, income distribution is actually getting better. The incomes of the poorest people are rising faster than the rich. That's what's happening in Brazil. It's happened in El Salvador. It's been happening in Indonesia. About a third of developing countries, it's getting worse. The richest people are getting richer. China is the biggest example of that. And in about a third of developing countries, it's actually not changing all that much. So it's a very mixed pattern, but it is not the case that income distribution is systematically getting worse in developing countries. In some, it is actually getting much better. And there's a long story about why that is. But that's the basic outlines of sort of the facts. Oxfam's report, which is a really interesting report, looks at the 100 richest people in the world. So they're looking at one small important segment and how wealth is concentrating into the very richest. And by that measure, income distribution is getting worse because wealth is concentrated in a small number of people. But it is a different way of thinking about a global income distribution.
So let's take a very fast-growing mm-hmm. economy, yep. though, Nigeria.
Yeah.
Very high growth, but that growth hasn't been as broad-based, as inclusive as one would want. What's the role for policy in a situation so, like that, local domestic policy?
Right. Well, in Nigeria, the worst thing that ever happened in Nigeria is that they found a lot of oil. It's actually a disaster for the country. And what it meant was everybody was fighting about oil. And people left the farms, agricultural production went way down. Nobody was focusing on manufacturing or services. Everybody wanted a slice of oil. And it was huge. It was not a little bit of oil. Up until a few years ago, 97% of Nigeria's exports were oil. And so, first of all, even if it was managed really well, that means your economy is going to go up and down, up and down, up and down with oil prices, which is really hard if you're honest and competent and everything else. That's really, really hard. When you throw in that maybe not so honest and not so competent, not so good at all. And all of the fighting around public policy was who's going to get the spoils, who can I hire, who are my friends, who's my family, who's going to get a slice of the oil pie. It's the worst thing that ever happened to them. Now, the plus, of course, run by one dictator after another that just reinforced this. In the last few years, there has been a movement towards, slowly, better governance. They had an election last year where the incumbent president lost, and he quietly stepped down and became loyal opposition and praised the election results and said the people have spoken, which for those of us that have been watching Nigeria for a long time, just kind of were a bit dumbfounded that happened, an excellent sign. And they have more competent economic managers that are trying to diversify away from oil. Right now, there's a big strain, obviously, because oil prices are falling. But I spoke recently to the former finance minister, who said she thinks that this could be a blessing in disguise, that it will force them to move towards policies that will begin to create the incentives for jobs in other sectors that can be more broad-based and not this reliance on oil. But, you know, the two things, this is going to be a little bit simple, but the two things that have really been hard in developing countries, if countries in conflict, and a lot of them were in conflict, disaster for development, number one. And number two, high concentration, especially on one natural resource. Countries in that situation have not done well at all. And Nigeria is a classic case.
There are some who think that one of the reasons that President Goodluck Jonathan lost that election was because he hadn't been effective in dealing with Boko Haram,
yeah.
With the terrorist group in the yep. north. Some of the question cards take us to another part of the world, mm-hmm. to the Middle East, that is also oil rich,
yep.
That has also not had a history of great governance.
Right.
And that is also facing this problem of
yep.
states, in essence, failing in the face
yep.
of
yep.
In the face of terror groups and networks.
Mm-hmm.
This questioner asks whether U.S. national interests have blocked development opportunities in places like Saudi Arabia just mm-hmm. because stability is so much of a focus of ours. And this one asks whether you believe democracy as envisioned by the West is a model that can work in the Middle East. And mm. you know, here's a region where pluralism doesn't have a great
right,
history.
Right. Well, those are two really easy questions. So on the first one, have U.S. interests blocked development in Saudi Arabia? Actually, that is a pretty easy question. Yes. It has. And, you know, I told the story about how that had those kinds of things had diminished at the end of the Cold War. And I think I put in a caveat that not everywhere. And I was thinking actually about Saudi Arabia at the time. For a long time, our national interest was around having a good relationship with Saudi Arabia, particularly after what happened in Iran in 1979, which was our other major oil supplier. And because of our appetite for oil and that we like gasoline prices at $2 a barrel or $2 a gallon, we have had a long relationship with Saudi Arabia and been more than willing to look the other direction in terms of their domestic politics and actually supporting some pretty extreme elements of Islam that has been exported in some bad ways. And so it is an example of where our interests do collide, and there are others like that. And there are no easy solutions to that, except that our history there is not particularly good. And I think we have gotten in the way, and we are reaping the benefits of that to some degree. It's a lot more complex than that, but that is certainly one element. The second question, can democracy come to the Middle East? Well, I hope so. And I talk a lot, I write about a lot this in the book. And I don't want to be sort of naive pie in the sky, but I do know that 70 years ago, most smart political commenters said that democracy was for Protestants. Max Weber, out of the work on the Protestant work ethic, democracy was working in countries that were moving forward, that were capitalist countries in Western Europe. And the earliest democracies were Protestant countries, and people took that to the crazy extreme. And there is literature written in the 1920s and 30s that Catholic countries will not become democracies because their ultimate allegiance is to the Pope, the dictator, the Pope. So we killed that canard because there are lots of Catholic countries that, but then it's a Christian concept. And, you know, fortunately, Japan killed that along and India killed that from an early stage. But it was this idea that it was that certain countries, certain groups, not apply. Then more recently, Lee Kuan Yew, the very successful prime minister of Singapore, in many ways very successful, not a Democrat, pushed hard on this idea of Asian values, that democracy was incompatible with Asian values. The great economist philosopher Amartya Sen, himself an Asian, took a dispute with that. But there was a view that that democracy was incompatible with Asia. We now have Indonesia, South Korea, the Philippines, India, and several other countries that have thrown that canard out the window. So then it shifted towards, obviously, democracy is not compatible with Islam. But we've had successful democratic elections in Senegal, in Niger, and several Western African countries, in Indonesia, the largest Muslim country in the world, where I lived for 4 years. And if someone would have told me when I was there, when Suharto was in charge, that there would be a thriving democracy in Indonesia today, I would have told them they were crazy. But the largest democracy, the largest Muslim country in the world, is a thriving democracy. So we've thrown out that canard. But the one place in the world where democracy has not really penetrated at all is in the Middle East. Tunisia is the one country coming out of the Arab Spring where there's been some progress. All of my instincts are obviously, with that introduction that I just gave to that answer, that in time it will spread there as well, and that there I don't see anything incompatible any more than it was incompatible with Asian values or with Catholic values, with the Pope or with Islam, that there's something about the Arab Middle East. I think it has much more to do with a lot of history that goes back, a lot about resources. I don't claim to be an expert on the Middle East, but I do I do not believe that the idea that people should be free to choose their own leaders and hold them accountable is a Western value. I just don't believe it. And I heard that when I lived in Indonesia, and it turned out it was wrong. And I've heard that in lots of other places, and it's been wrong. I do believe that people around the world want to be able to choose their own leaders and hold them accountable, which is what democracy is all about for all of its imperfections. And so I do believe that at some point, imperfectly, we will find that begin to move to the Middle East as well, or at least that's my hope.
I'm going to sort of weave together 3 points for three seemingly unrelated issues, but I know you can connect them. The first is that in your book, you point to, after describing the gains that have made you point to some headwinds that can reverse those gains. Right. And corruption was way up there in one of them, civil conflict.
Yep.
Climate change. I don't think it's kept only to things that began with C, but as a set of headwinds. And I wanted to say a word about that. And I wanted to turn to one of the questioners. One of the questioners asked about the Mo Ibrahim Award, which is designed to incentivize good governance in Africa. And the question is, do things like that work, what is the place for that?
Mm-hmm.
And another questioner, and this is a common theme coming from these cards, is the question of sort of where a sort of global priority setting and resource mobilization can fit. So on the local level, how do you ensure transparent and accountable government? Mm-hmm. On the global level, what's the role for things like the Sustainable Development Goals?
Mm-hmm. That's enough. So
I'll wait for the third.
So let me So I do want to, you know, point out for all this good news, there are still 700 million people that live under $1.90 a day, which is something that no one in this room, I think, can conceive of. I've been living in developing countries for a long time, and I still really can't conceive it. There are still too many, 6 million children a year that die of unnecessary diseases. There are still too many countries that are really poorly governed and too many people that wake up every day and not knowing where the next meal will come from. So there's still a very, very, very long way to go. And there are big headwinds out there, not the least of which is climate change, which is going to make this much more difficult because some of the world's most fragile countries are just these that have been making a lot of success, but it's still pretty fragile. And if all of a sudden agricultural productivity falls and they're not able to grow as much food, especially with rising populations, and if climate change adds to that, there's all kinds of risks that if we don't deal with it, a lot of this could be reversed. So there are a lot of headwinds. I think that creating the incentives for good governance is enormous. I don't know exactly how much Mo Ibrahim's prize. He gives $1 million away periodically to a retired African leader that he believes has done well. I think he's given it away 3 times or maybe 4.
Well, they need to have entered office democratically and left
and
democratically.
Left democratically. I don't think that in and of itself that's going to motivate too many African leaders, but I think it helps. It creates a little bit of publicity. The real drivers for good governance are the people of the countries themselves and the leaders, the church leaders, the civil society leaders, the business leaders that are demanding property rights and freedoms and basic rights and responsibilities and want that good governance. That's where the real incentive comes from. And that is both the puzzle here is the challenge here is that is the key to sustaining long-term development, but it's a real threat to any leader because that means for any leader to give away more of their power and to diffuse their power, to give more of those roles and responsibility to citizens. And so it's the right thing to do in the long run, but it's a threat. It's a threat in the shorter run. So, but we're not going to be able. We, the global community, we're not going to be able to meet these challenges in the absence of good governance, whether it's in developing countries themselves or at some global level. And so I guess the way I'd come back on this is one of the reasons why this is so important for us here in the United States. I deeply believe that to solve the problems that we face around climate change, around our own economic issues, around our own political challenges, around the many challenges we face, we need as many people around the world who share the same basic values and goals that we do of having economic opportunity, of having the chance to put their kids in school, having the chance to vote for their leaders and hold them accountable, having a chance to think that the next generation can be better off than that generation. We need like-minded allies. And that's what we're creating. That's what we have helped create, frankly, in the last 20 or 25 years. And we need to continue to encourage that because we're not going to be able to solve the problems with climate change on our own. We're not going to be able to fight ISIS and stop terrorist networks and criminal networks and drug networks in developing countries without enabling and building the capacity of the public sector and the people in those countries to fight those battles with us. Groups like Al-Qaeda started in Sudan. Why? Because it was a poorly governed place and they could go there and nobody would bother them. Then they went to Afghanistan. Why? Because nobody would bother them and they could operate with impunity out of Afghanistan. The warlords were doing their thing and they could just do that. If we're ever going to solve these problems of fighting against those groups, we need to empower the local people and local government to have the financial wherewithal and the political wherewithal to stand with us to begin to solve those problems. So this is very much in our long-term interest, and things like the Mo Ibrahim Prize will help do that, and things fighting corruption and building the capacity of those governments is going to help build the long-term prosperity of the people in those countries, but it is going to build allies for us that we can work with and argue with and debate with and throw dirt at each other and say, you know, just like within our own family reunions that we have every year. We all argue and then we get together and we solve things and we get things done. And we have moved way far in that direction, I think, in a good way that people don't realize. And developing countries are now looking at us to continue to be models. I fear that we're slipping a little bit in terms of that role. But helping to encourage those countries to continue to build their own systems is good for them, but it's going to be good for us too.
So we don't have time for the last question, so I'm going to treat it as a statement, because the last question asked whether we needed virtual reality to understand the world as it is. And I think what I would argue is, having just read this book, that this is a book that helps us understand the world as it is and imagine the world as it can be. And nothing better can be said about a book. So please join me in thanking Steve Radelet.